majority of the Western world. The headline then refers to a documentary put together by a Canadian company to remark the 50th anniversary of the famine, a documentary called Harvest of Despair. Although the documentary began in 1985 to pick up prize after prize as a brilliant and revealing cinematic documentation of what the Soviet Union had perpetrated, for some reason, that prize-winning documentary was not being shown in America, not by CBS, not by NBC, not by ABC. It was being spiked, Mr. Pollack was telling us, just as the original famine had been spiked. Well, what about PBS? Mr. Pollack went on to complain of the general inhospitality to the Harvest of Despair, citing the mere handful of American cities that had actually shown the documentary. PBS volunteered to sponsor a special primetime 2 hours to be devoted to the Great Famine under the auspices of Firing Line. Those 2 hours have just now begun. Our guests are first and indeed foremost Dr. Robert Conquest. Dr. Conquest is the premier scholar of the subject under discussion, and his book on it will be published by the Oxford University Press next month. It is called Harvest of Sorrow, Soviet Collectivization and the Terror Famine. Professor Conquest is perhaps best known for his book, The Great Terror, the classic work on the Stalinist era. He's written widely on the Soviet Union, but is also a poet and literary critic. Mr. Conquest was educated at Winchester College at the University of Grenoble and at Magdalen in Oxford before serving in the British infantry and in the diplomatic service. He is currently a senior research fellow at the Hoover Institute, a research associate of the Harvard University Ukrainian Research Institute, and a fellow of the Georgetown University Center for Strategic and International Studies. Our second guest is also a renowned Sovietologist, Harrison Salisbury, a longtime correspondent of the New York Times, including a long stretch in the Soviet Union. Mr. Salisbury is a graduate of the University of Minnesota and the author of a dozen books, many of them on the Soviet Union. He won a Pulitzer Prize for his reporting from Moscow during and after the war. Mr. Christopher Hitchens is the Washington columnist for the London Spectator and also for The Nation magazine. He writes also for the Times Literary Supplement and The Observer. He attended Lay's School in Cambridge and Balliol at Oxford, and during the 70s wrote for The New Statesman. In about 15 minutes, we will show the famous documentary, The Harvest of Despair, which lasts 55 minutes. I have not myself seen the documentary. The interval between now and the documentary will be devoted to a historical discussion of the events of 1932 and 1933. No evaluations, please, not yet. That will come later, after we have all seen the prize-winning documentary, never before shown on network television in America. I'd like to begin by asking Mr. Conquest to tell us what, in 1932, was the relationship between Russia and the Ukraine?
Well, the Ukraine had, in effect, been conquered in the Civil War, and local governments, local nationalist governments, were overthrown by the Red Army. The Bolsheviks never got more than 10% of the vote in the elections there. They had granted the Ukraine quite a lot of cultural independence up to about 1930. They had, to a certain extent, silenced the or appeased national feeling. But then you get the attack on the peasantry of the Soviet Union as a whole in 1930. This famine is only one episode, the worst of quite a campaign. The dekulakization, the sending north of 10 million peasants, thought to be particularly opposed to the regime, where they mostly, a large proportion of them starved, the collectivization of the land, which we still have, the remaining peasants being put in the collective farms, and then in 32, and 30 to 32, an attack on the Ukrainian intelligentsia, most of whom were eventually arrested, and this attack on the Ukrainian peasantry, which consisted, as you say, of starving an area consisting of the Ukraine and certain districts to its east.
Well, now, did the Ukraine represent a distinctive problem to the Soviet Union in 32 that other states or provinces, as you like, did not represent? Was there a special firebrand, a nationalism that provoked Stalin, or what?
I think they nationalism was very strong in a general sense. When you call a man a nationalist, he may still be a communist if he thinks the communists will let him be a national person as well. But also the Ukraine had shown much more rebellion against collectivization probably than any other areas. They were the worst peasants in Stalin's sense. But more generally, the Ukraine has always been troubled. I think Harrison would agree. You get this in before the revolution, that leading extreme right-wingers say the Russian Empire can survive without Poland, without Georgia, not without the Ukraine. The Ukraine, once that's gone, we're no longer a great power. So it's a terrifically awkward place for a leader in Moscow.
Mr. Salisbury, you were about to say...
I just wanted to roll it back a little bit further than Bob has. Ukraine, of course, is really the cradle of Russian civilization and the church. Kiev was the place where Russia as an entity first came into being, and the early emperors and the early church were all centered there in Kiev.
I'm going to stick this up here in case the camera wants to remind people where the Ukraine is, since we were told by the Secretary of Education that Americans don't know geography.
They don't know it very well, I must say.
Ukraine,
anyway, was really the cradle of Russia. I think there's no question about that. And we can't go over the whole history, but the first Christian part of Russia was the Ukraine. This is where the Christian missionaries first came out of Bulgaria and established, converted the emperor there. And so when we talk about the Ukraine and Russia, we're not really talking about separate countries. We're talking about two parts of a country or a civilization that moved on different ways. Unfortunately, the Ukraine, being the advanced part of Russia, was the area which probably suffered most under the Mongol invasion in the 13th century, which really wiped out the Ukraine. And only that part of Russia, which was very backward and was in the deep forests further north, around Moscow, survived, or were able to survive more or less. And when the Russian nationalism began to come back and the dynasty built itself up, in Moscow and that particular region, which gave a special characteristic to that part of Russia. And I suppose if we want to look for the roots of this problem, they go far back of communism or anything like that, because the Ukrainians always feel a superiority. They're the real Russian civilization.
Well, this cultural independence that Mr. Conquest has referred to was vouchsafed as a result of an evening of magnanimity in Lenin and Stalin, or was it because they felt they were contending with an irrepressible force in the Ukraine?
Well, you have to then take a big leap to the time of the revolution and see what happened there. As you probably remember, Bill, when the revolution occurred, the Germans took advantage of it and moved in, and Ukraine, being very independent and very hostile toward the communists for the most part, set up its own regime, a very nationalist regime, and it was a key area in the struggle against Bolshevism. It went back and forth. I think the bloodiest fighting in Russia occurred in the Ukraine again and again, and finally, after the revolution survived, they put this the Ukraine down in a very bloody way and repressed it undoubtedly more sharply than they did.
You're talking about 1917 or 1918?
I'm talking about, well, this is later, because it wasn't really settled out until around the 20s, the early 20s, that they finally got control. And even when they did, Ukrainian resistance continued in the mountains and the hills for, well, I guess it writes straight through to the present day, wouldn't you say so?
Probably may still be some in the
That's
West
right.
Ukraine.
So there's a bloody history that goes back of this.
Okay, so in 1932, what has happened, I take it, is that the collectivization program of Stalin has been consummated, right?
Yeah.
But still, Ukraine is doing what that aggravates Stalin? Who wants to volunteer and answer that question?
Well, I say the first thing was the Ukrainian peasantry had resisted collectivization more strongly than the Ukrainian and the North Caucasian peasantry than any other part.
What happened to people who resisted collectivization?
Well, they got they were sent north, they were shot.
What's that?
There were rebellions, the villages were
So they were already coped with, theoretically.
Well, yes, but the whole population was obviously behind them, virtually. Secondly, there was, as Harrison says, there was this notion that the Ukraine is too independent. They wanted to. The first Bolshevik regimes in the Ukraine both tried to put down Ukrainianism totally. In fact, they almost made it illegal to speak Ukrainian. Then eventually it was so difficult, as Harrison says, they had to make concessions. In the early 30s, they withdrew most of these concessions. They shot or sent to camps. They had about 260 members of the Writers' Union there, and over 200 were shot or sent to camps.
So we're still talking about 32.
Yep, in that
period. We don't want to go past the period of this.
No, that's
if you come just before that, Bill, to go in, you said collectivization has been consummated. I don't know that it ever was consummated, to be quite honest, but they had imposed a collectivization of the sort, and under armed force and requisition and shooting peasants and shipping the so-called kulaks off to Siberia in large numbers.
Yeah, well, however imperfect the program, I mean, the civil rights reforms have not been consummated, but the civil rights program is done.
Yes.
In that sense, it was done. What I'm trying to alert the audience to is that what we're about to see, as I understand it, was not a part of the collectivization crusade of the Soviet Union. It was part of a different crusade, am I correct?
Well, it linked with the collectivization, I think one would say.
Why haven't you contradicted it yet?
It's of interest, I think, that that George Orwell's Animal Farm had a huge public among Ukrainians when it was a book that wasn't yet well known. And that the preface that he writes to Animal Farm is actually the preface to the Ukrainian edition that he published in 1946. And it seemed that Ukrainians, when they read the book, felt that it very specially described what had happened to them, recognized themselves in it. I just add that I haven't the expertise or experience either of Harrison Salisbury or Dr. Conquest.
It wasn't because of the metaphors used.
Well, I think this, they felt rather as Milosz recalls Poles saying in the 50s, they were surprised to find that Orwell had never lived in a communist state. They felt he'd got, somehow the texture replicated very well. It's also true, and I add this to see if it's of interest or if it reminds you of anything, that Trotsky predicted that there would be a war with Nazism, that the Hitler-Stalin Pact, even though it was the only pact Stalin ever kept, would be broken. And he predicted that the Nazis would win the war. And the reason he gave for that was that
From
Mexico.
Mexico.
Predicted that the war would come and that Stalin would lose it. And the reason he gave was that there were large areas of the Soviet Union, such as the Ukraine, where even a Nazi invasion would be welcomed.
But that was post this.
Well, I think he had in mind the whole experience and maltreatment of the national minorities and of the peasantry. This is to leap ahead, it's to break your injunction. Perhaps I should stop here, but simply to say that it is indeed true that that did happen. And if one imagines the people so much reduced as to welcome the Wehrmacht, one can only imagine what life was like before.
That isn't so unusual if you understand the history of the Ukraine, because they always had a much closer relationship with the Germans than the rest of Russia. But one other factor I think we ought to think about, and that is that what is the character of the Ukraine? The Ukraine is the Iowa of Russia. It's the breadbasket of Russia or the Soviet Union, whatever you want to call it. It's the
also huge.
Wonderful crops, wonderful animal husbandry, more advanced agriculture than most parts of Russia. It is more favorably located because it's south. The climate is better. So that, in general, it has a way of life and always has had, which is superior to that of the rest of Russia. And the Ukrainians are very proud of this and regard themselves as separate and different from what they would call probably the rather illiterate and backward Russian peasant.
Good for nuclear energy too, right?
They have that now, yes.
Well, what do you say we have a look, shall we? I give you the Harvest of Sorrow. Is it the Harvest of Despair?
The year 1933. The
place, the Soviet Union. Behind the facade, food is being used as a weapon against peoples who have proven troublesome to Moscow. Famine is engineered deliberately in the North Caucasus, the Volga Basin, and Ukraine. The Soviet secret police seal off Ukraine's borders. No one can get out or bring food in. A nation the size of France is strangled by hunger. In less than 2 years, 10 million people die. 7 million of them in Ukraine. 3 million of them children.
Precisely because of the deliberation with which it was done and the total absence of even any kind of sympathy.
If you revive this terrible past, and you are always shaken again, and it moves you again, and you can't get rid of these terrible pictures you have seen or these terrible reports you have gotten in this period.
Nearest city was 40 miles, so I walked about once a week or so to that city. I could buy for my salary 2 loaves of bread a month. So that's only how we could survive. But the peasants were dying.
This was the first time in my life that I saw people dying. And of course it was very hard.
The untold story of Ukraine's darkest tragedy begins at a time of great optimism and joy in March 1917. A tidal wave of revolution sweeps aside the mighty Tsarist Empire. National boundaries change rapidly with the dramatic shifting of power. Ukrainians grasp the chance to reclaim their independence after 200 years of Russian domination. Kiev, Ukraine's ancient capital, is once again the seat of government. Ukraine's rich and fertile land has supplied Europe with grain for countless generations. Even the ancient Greeks depended on her abundant stores of wheat. History has taught Ukraine that freedom has a price. The people prepare to defend their national republic against all invaders. December 1917. Having consolidated Bolshevik control in Russia, Lenin prepares to reclaim the former Tsarist territories.
ensuing years of chaos, Ukrainians fight Lenin's Red Army, Denikin's White Army, Germans, Poles. Whether the armies march in as enemies or allies, the price is always measured in tons of food. This bountiful country is slowly bled dry. 1921, the dust of battle finally settles. Russia has retaken the major part of the country. Western Ukraine is carved up between Poland, Romania, and Czechoslovakia. The Soviet conquerors ship out more and more grain to feed Moscow. A drought adds to Ukraine's misery. Millions die as the breadbasket of Europe experiences its first famine. Yet this is but a preview of the tragedy to follow. To end the continued resistance to Bolshevik rule, Lenin adopts a new economic policy. Grain requisitions are canceled. The peasant farmer is allowed to trade freely on the open market. The impact on Ukraine is dynamic. 80% of her population are farmers. Hoping to win further support, Lenin tolerates the national revival which has been gathering momentum since the 1917 revolution in Kiev. Ukraine's blossoming renaissance is so powerful, Lenin's successor, Stalin, views the loss of Russian influence with increasing alarm. Ivan Maestrenko was a Marxist instructor of journalism in Soviet Ukraine.
A meeting of the Politburo heard a report that students in Kiev no longer know how to speak Russian. Everyone was shocked. How can that be, they asked. Well, in Ukrainian schools during the 20s, the Russian language was treated like French, German, etc., as a foreign language. And that's why students who came from Ukrainian schools didn't know Russian. And not knowing Russian constituted a clear threat that Kiev would become the capital of an independent Ukraine.
Thousands of Ukrainian language parishes spring up across the country. For the first time since the 17th century, the Ukrainian Orthodox Church re-establishes its independence from the Moscow Patriarchate. In the arts, the flourishing avant-garde models itself on Western, not Russian, culture. Literary circles abound. Writers and poets develop a uniquely Ukrainian literature. Ukraine's leading communist writer, Mykola Khmelyovey, elaborates on the dangerous slogan, "Away from Moscow." Even the leader of the Ukrainian Communist Party, Mykola Skripnik, sees the USSR as a kind of League of Nations and argues for greater cultural and political autonomy to win Ukrainians over to communism.
Mykola Skripnik really saw himself as an equal to Stalin, as an independent national ruler. I mean, when he went to Moscow, he'd take a translator, even though he spoke perfect Russian. He tried with some success to establish a cultural protectorate over Ukrainian communities in Russia. He even called for the direct annexation of border areas with the majority of Ukrainians to Soviet Ukraine. So he was actually making territorial demands against Stalin.
By 1928, Stalin is a law unto himself. This efficient, ruthless administrator has eliminated all effective opposition within the Politburo. The dream of a worldwide communist revolution has not materialized. As Stalin strengthens communism within the borders of the USSR, Russian nationalism is increasingly injected into his policies. The strong cultural individuality of Ukraine is no longer tolerated. 1929, Stalin strikes at the nation's heart and mind, its church and intelligentsia. Over the next few years, the systematic liquidation of intellectuals is carried out by the communist regime in Ukraine. 5,000 scholars, scientists, poets, and artists prominent during Ukraine's independence are arrested for allegedly belonging to the SVU, a secret organization the Soviets claim is planning an armed insurrection. Only 45 get a public trial. No evidence is considered necessary. Thousands upon thousands are imprisoned, deported, and executed later as mass arrests continue throughout the 30s. Even the church is accused of involvement in this alleged plot.
Many priests were arrested. Many were sent to Siberian concentration camps. Many shot. My father was one of them. He never came back. I know this from personal experience. 30 bishops were murdered, thousands of priests were perished, hundred thousands of faithful were liquidated. Metropolitan Vasily Pkivsky and his two successors were arrested too. To this day, we don't know what happened to them.
Церкви було повно людей.
The church was full of people.
На конях.
Some communists rode inside on horseback and ordered me to undress. It was March. There was snow outside. The snow was melting, and I walked in water up to my knees while they rode on horseback. They interrogated me, but I didn't answer their questions. And for this, I was rewarded with pistol blows across my back.
They began taking down the icons and smashing them on the ground. The people wanted to go inside the church, but they didn't let them. They ruined everything, smashed everything in the church. And the people stood outside crying because they couldn't do anything. When a man went up to remove the bell, and that bell fell to the ground and rang out, all the people burst into tears. Everyone was weeping and saying goodbye to the bell, because that was the last time that bell rang.
By 1930, only the Russian Orthodox Church remains. In October 1928, Stalin introduces a drastic five-year plan to transform the Soviet Union from a backward rural society into a modern, self-sufficient industrial empire, virtually overnight. Military defense takes priority. Socialism must be protected from all future enemies. Western technology is urgently needed. To pay for it, Stalin must seize the only exportable resource, grain. And so he decrees the compulsory collectivization of agriculture. Henceforth, all private lands, livestock, and farming implements will belong to the state. The farmer will work as a laborer for pay, like a worker in a factory.
One of the intriguing elements in the Ukraine was that it brought together both the peasant question and the nationality question in a way that was somewhat different than in other areas. Because in the Ukraine, Ukrainians tended to concentrate in rural areas, and in the city areas, particularly in the eastern Ukraine, it was Russian and Jewish populations that dominated. So that any policies that the Bolsheviks adopted toward the peasants had an obvious impact on Ukrainians very directly.
With the destruction of the intellectuals and the church well underway, collectivization allows Stalin to break the farmers, the backbone of the nation. Anticipating fierce resistance, he orders the liquidation of the kulaks as a class. Kulak is a Bolshevik label for the wealthier farmers who own 24 acres of land or hire labor. They are considered the potential leaders in any revolt. The state confiscates not only the lands of the farmers, classified as kulaks, but also all their possessions. It is forbidden by law to assist these enemies of the people. Miroslava Vudka was 7 when her father was exiled. She never saw him again.
In the winter of 1931, they came to evict us from our house. Activists, a group of people, if they could be called people, came into the house and looked over everything and made us very frightened. Then they said, get out. This isn't your house anymore. But mother wouldn't leave. At least let us spend the rest of the winter here, she begged. Where can I go with these children and old people? The men picked her up and threw her outside. A militiaman or activist stood in the doorway as a guard. Mother shouted to us, children, don't leave the house. There were tears and screams. It was frightening. We grabbed hold of the benches in the house, screaming and refusing to let go. Then the men began to take us out one by one. They would throw one of us outside and then another. Thus, they threw us out of the house, one by one, all 6 of us.
A courageous neighbor risked deportation to give her family shelter. Some farmers burn their crops, kill their livestock, and flee to the cities. But over the next 3 years, 1 million men, women, and children are rounded up, jammed into sealed boxcars, and shipped off to the remotest corners of the Soviet Union. Survivors work as slave labor, producing raw materials for export to the West. This is the end of the line for many of the best farmers and cultural and religious leaders of Ukraine. Party activists are brought in from the cities to push through collectivization. Anyone who opposes the measures is denounced as a kulak and deported. Yet resistance comes from all quarters. Not so long ago, the Bolsheviks had given land to the poor. Now they want to take it away.
Thank God I didn't kill anyone. I didn't have anyone put away. I didn't inform on anyone. But I wrote. I was an agitator. I attended meetings and also told the peasants, bring in the grain, hand over the grain. The workers have nothing to eat. There's a world crisis. Hitler has taken over in Germany. The Japanese are advancing into Manchuria. Our country is a fortress that's surrounded by enemies on all sides. And I yelled and begged and swore and threatened, of course. Anyone who doesn't bring in grain had better watch out for the punishing sword of the proletarian dictatorship. Well, I rattled on, as we all did, and believed that it was necessary. My father was very much against collectivization. He said they were ruining the village. The that the Bolsheviks knew nothing about farm management, that even the old landlords were better managers than the Soviet district officials. But when you're 18 or 20 years old, who believes his father?
In 1930, Petro Grigorenko was one of the many students brought in from the cities to harvest the grain.
There was rebellion, then sabotage. People did not give up. They attacked the local authorities, usually not killing anyone. They only tied them up and threw them into a barn or simply drove them from the village. And they took back their property, took back their horses, cows, and implements, which had just been taken by the collective. They would take all that back. To crush the rebellions, troops were sent in. They would shoot over the people's heads, but they would also shoot at their heads and their hearts.
Vasily Sokil witnessed a squad of GPU secret police attacking a lone, defiant farmer.
They formed a wide circle around the house. When they realized that the farmer inside had no more bullets left, they threw a grenade into the attic. After that, everything fell silent. The fact of that armed resistance burned itself into my memory. I saw that even under those terrible conditions, there were people who believed in fighting for the right to live as the Ukrainian farmer had always lived.
The wheat is left standing in the fields. The demoralized farmers respond to the ruinous taxes and the presence of troops by simply refusing to work. The grain quotas or taxes are deliberately raised to exceed what the individual farmers can possibly produce. Either they join the collectives where the taxes are three times lower or face exile as kulaks. By mid-1932, three-quarters of all Ukrainian farms are collectivized. Then, in August, crippling new quotas are levied on the collectives themselves. Another exorbitant quota is levied in October, and yet another at the beginning of the new year. These levies are impossible to meet.
The working people were getting rationing card, and they could get food from the warehouse in the village. Like 1 liter of milk and 2 pounds of bread for a week. But the farmers, the peasants, they could not get anything any place. And so they had nothing to eat right away the second day after those people from government took everything from them.
The regime blames the farmers for the stringent food rationing in the cities. In reality, the Soviets are dumping tons of wheat on Western markets. The 1932 harvest yields enough grain to have fed the entire population of Ukraine for 2 years. Instead, famine ravages the country.
It was a spoken order. Stalin gave it. That there was a definite plan, I knew from the instructions given us by Stanislav Kosyor, the secretary of the Communist Party of Ukraine. He said, the kulak wants to crush our Soviet government with the bony hand of famine. We will bend this bony hand back on the throat of the kulak.
The Russians came from house to house and took all the foods the people had in the house, starting with grain, flour, wheat, or what barley or whatever they had, up to the last drop of food. They took the beets, the beans, potatoes, whatever they had in cellars or in the house. And besides that, they didn't trust them. They started searching the houses, looking all over, digging in the house, and holes in floors, digging in the ovens, ruining their ovens. And so they went from house to house and took everything from peasants.
The farmers crowd into the cities, selling heirlooms, anything, in order to buy the bread they themselves have produced. An internal passport system is introduced to deliberately confine them to their villages. 1932, Stalin condemns the Ukrainian party's urgent appeals to reduce quotas and send aid. He accuses them of placing local interests above the success of the five-year plan. The war for bread is the war for socialism, he says. Stalin's trusted envoy, Pavel Postyshev, is given sweeping dictatorial powers and sent into Ukraine with an army of secret police to purge the Ukrainian party ranks and to squeeze out the last kernels of grain. 112,000 trusted party members from Russia are now stationed in Ukraine. They guard the standing crops and livestock from the starving, brutally enforcing the law to protect state property.
This was a horrible law. If they saw a child picking a stalk of wheat, trying to eat those unripe grains, that was a very serious crime. This was a government order to punish anyone, even to death by execution.
Not only do all state quotas have to be met, but additional grain has to be set aside for seed and livestock before the collective farm workers get paid. 80% of the collectives fail to pay their workers anything at all. And a new draconian measure prevents the workers from searching for work elsewhere.
The collective farm where my father worked had stood since 1928. It was a good, strong farm. But although this was the best farm around, it was suffering even more than the others because they were disciplined and had everything organized on time. Well, government trucks would pull right up to the winnowing machines and take everything. They even took the chaff. My father was already swollen. Not too much, but his feet were swollen and his eyes, all in the typical look of starvation. And in the house, there was nothing left but half a pumpkin, and that's all. I went to the collective farm to get horses. There, a friend of mine from the Communist Youth League said weakly, "He came to take your father away? Well, take him. Maybe he'll survive, but it's too late for us."
Village mothers, dying of hunger, throw their children onto trains heading into the cities in the desperate hope someone will take pity and feed them.
I entered the car, railroad car, and then I saw it was full of children. Some of them were enormously thin, but others were thin at the top of the body, but their legs were and stomachs were enormously swollen. Some of them had convulsions. In general, if a child was lying very quietly, we already knew this child will die soon.
During the day, people would hide. You couldn't see them anywhere. But at night, they would come out like shadows, lining up in front of the bread stores, hoping maybe to get some bread in the morning. Only homeless children could be seen walking in the streets. Homeless children and starving women in rags and dead bodies, children stepping over them. That's how the city of Kharkiv looked then.
It is hard to imagine how long those lines were for the so-called commercial bread. They lined up by the thousand, or two, or three, and even as many as 7,000.
Andor Henke was the German consul stationed in Kiev. He and his family witnessed the horrors of the famine firsthand.
I ran out of the consulate because the Russian newspapers were reporting that there was a famine in Germany, but that everything was wonderful in Russia. I became very angry and took pictures of the corpses.
Doch ich habe also noch eine relativ lebhafte Erinnerung an die Zeit in Kiew.
I still have a very vivid memory of that time in Kiev. We were children at the time. My sister was 4 years younger than I. We lived in the consulate like in a golden cage. We weren't allowed to go out in the streets alone during this time. Nevertheless, I remember the misery and the famine very well. I remember seeing bodies everywhere, in doorways, on street corners. Wagons would take them away. They were picked up, thrown in, and driven away.
Some of them were still alive, but they were all thrown on a pile and taken out of the city and thrown into a pit and covered with earth. The children, teenagers, girls, boys, went along stumbling and falling and begging for bread. I couldn't take it. I went home and I screamed and cried hysterically.
We survived thanks to parishioners, the railroad employees who had the chance to travel beyond the borders of Ukraine. And we had neighbors, Soviet officials. They always had food. We came through their garbage cans. We eat rotten potatoes, rotten cabbage and beets, and the scraps of food which they threw away. I am not ashamed to admit it, because it was a matter of survival. I didn't want to die.
When we reached the state farm and met the manager, he hired us to work there. He told us we would work at night, feeding the horses linseed cakes mixed with chopped straw. He said we should do this when people are asleep, because if they were awake, they would eat the horse's fodder. We said, how can we do that? People are more important than horses. But he said, we need the horses to cart the corpses away. They collected the corpses from the houses. A deep sleigh would stop at every house, and the men would ask, do you have any? Thank God, we have none. Then they'd stop at the next house. Have you got any? Yes. Well, bring them out. But I don't have the strength. Then two or three young men, themselves with swollen legs, go into the house, bring out the corpse, and place it in the sleigh. They'd collect 2, 3, 4 a day.
In the spring, when my little sister died, her body lay in the house a whole week. We kept it until Mother came back from the state farm. People would come to our house and knock on the door every day, asking whether we had any corpses. We'd shout, "No, we don't." Then the wagon would continue down the street collecting corpses. When Mother came home, we had to bury my sister. How could we bury her? There was nothing for a coffin. We wrapped her in a sheet, placed her on a sled, and took her to the cemetery. We put her between two coffins in a big grave. Coffins were placed on top also. And that's how we buried her.
Half a world away, kinsmen of the famine victims voice protests and form relief committees. Help is offered from Canada, the United States, Switzerland, France, Belgium. Cardinal Initzer initiates relief in Austria. Metropolitan Sheptytsky in western Ukraine. But all shipments of food grind to a halt at the Soviet border. The Soviet Red Cross flatly denies the existence of famine. The hands of the international organization are tied. Metropolitan Mstislav was then a deputy in the Polish parliament. He helped to organize relief efforts by Ukrainians living under Polish rule.
Our attempts to ship the grain into Ukraine were coordinated through the Soviet embassy in Warsaw. They told us this was not in their jurisdiction and that they would relay the request to the central government in Moscow. But Moscow's communications to us were, "What are you doing? Why would we need grain? We have had a wonderful harvest. There is no famine of any kind. This is nothing but anti-Soviet propaganda, that's all." So they gave us no hope of any kind that the grain would ever get there.
Spring 1933. The man-made famine reaches its height. 25,000 are dying every day. 1,000 an hour. 17 human beings every minute.
They tried to fool the people, telling them the famine was from natural causes. But the people saw that the famine was not from natural causes. No matter how hard they tried to hide the grain sealed inside mills and silos, people somehow found out there was plenty of grain, but they wouldn't give out any. Most of the grain was inside state mills. They were filled, and nobody was allowed near them. Some of it was piled high in the yard in sacks, covered with canvas, and it just rotted away. When I came to Mehedyuka that first time, all the bushes were still green, but when I came back, there was not a single leaf left. They ate it all. You couldn't hear a dog bark in the village, because they were eaten also.
We were told, children, it's very dangerous to go begging for food from house to house now. Terrible crimes are happening. You may not have heard, but a man who was going to the well for water or was coming back from the well fell and froze to death. His wife cut off pieces of his flesh and ate them.
My cousin, who was much younger than I, had three children. And those three children were eaten by their neighbors.
A directive issued by the Justice Department ensures that no official records of cannibalism are kept. All such cases are withdrawn from the courts and dealt with behind the closed doors of the OGPU secret police. Having killed a quarter of the nation's population, the Soviets staged one of the greatest cover-ups in history. At a grain conference in London, the Soviets campaigned vigorously to raise their grain export quotas from 25 to 85 million bushels of wheat. The scheme is effective. Few can imagine a state exporting grain at the cost of its own people's lives. Indignant over the mass unemployment and hardships in their own countries, many influential socialist sympathizers unwittingly rally to Moscow's defense. George Bernard Shaw and a party of leading British socialites visit the USSR and report, quite truthfully, that the restaurants where they eat are full of food. Another important foreign guest to receive the red carpet treatment is former French Prime Minister Edouard Herriot. He is actually given a five-day guided tour of Ukraine at the height of the famine. His favorable impressions of the country receive widespread publicity.
I would like to thank the government and the people of the Soviet Union for their warm reception.
Johann von Herwart was a young attaché at the German embassy in Moscow, and after the Second World War, German ambassador to Great Britain. He recalls how the Soviets stage-managed Herriot's entire trip.
The famous visit of the president of the French cabinet, Herriot, when he came to Kiev, then he had the impression that everything was all right in Kiev. The streets were well cleaned through which he drove. He got a wonderful breakfast in his hotel, and then in the streets there were trucks labeled bread, and bread was unloaded, and everything seemed to be fine. And then he went to see a collective farm, and when he spoke to the farmers, nobody knows if they were really farmers or put there just for the inspection of Herriot. They told him that everything was fine, much better than under the Tsars, and he came home and said, there's no famine in Ukraine. The peasants are very happy.
Idealized scenes of work and happy peasant life are the staple diet in Soviet movie theaters as the famine rages on. A sensational show trial is staged in Moscow to further help distract the Soviet people from the failures of the five-year plan. Six British engineers working in the USSR face the death sentence on trumped-up charges of sabotage, espionage, and bribery. The interest the trial arouses in the West gives the Soviets extra leverage to muzzle the foreign press corps. Correspondents are bluntly told that if they want access to the trial, they are not to mention the famine in their dispatches. Having served their purpose, the British saboteurs are eventually released. Malcolm Muggeridge arrived in the USSR in 1932. He was one of the very few journalists to defy the Soviet travel ban and report on the real conditions in the countryside.
I don't think that foreigners realize sufficiently how completely the Soviet authorities can control the foreign press. In the sense it worked simply that if you wrote a message, you had to take it along to the press department. I mean, the telegraph company wouldn't accept it unless it was stamped by them. You had to submit it to them. And they would read it through, and they would say, you can't say that. As I began to be very critical of the whole setup, to criticize the use of terrorism by the government, the articles that I wrote on the famine would undoubtedly, I would have had to leave, but I sent those over in a diplomatic bag. They would never have got out of the country otherwise, and I left before they had appeared.
For every article on the famine that appeared, two were published denying its existence. Muggeridge recalls the most influential correspondent in Moscow was Walter Duranty, the Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist for the New York Times.
He was not only the greatest liar among the journalists in Moscow, but he was the greatest liar of any journalist that I ever met in the 50 years of journalism. And we used to wonder whether, in fact, the authorities hadn't got some kind of hold over him, because he so utterly played their game. But it didn't worry the New York Times, who featured his reports. When it came to the famine, the great famine in the Ukraine, brought about by collectivization, that was when his reporting was particularly disgraceful, because he denied that there was any famine.
The Soviets actually grant Duranty permission to tour Ukraine unchaperoned. He reports in the Times that all talk of famine now is ridiculous. Yet documents from the British Foreign Office reveal that in private conversations at the British Embassy, Duranty said as many as 10 million people had died.
When they were discussing the question of recognizing the Soviet Union, the United States government recognizing the Soviet Union, the articles of Duranty were considered as very valuable evidence on the side of recognition.
Shortly after Soviet Foreign Minister Maxim Litvinov visits Washington in November 1933, the U.S. recognizes the Soviet government and enters agreements securing a balance of trade in favor of the United States. The following year, the Soviet cover-up achieves its ultimate success, a seat in the League of Nations. And this in spite of the fact Western governments knew all about the famine.
The government of Weimar, the democratic government, was well aware of what was going on in the Soviet Union. But the attitude of the government was, I would say, you could call it passive. And with the younger ones of the embassy, we always were of the opinion then at that period that we ought not to have any commercial relations with a criminal government which allowed hundreds of thousands and even millions of people to starve. The government said, we had already great unemployment in Germany, and if we stopped delivering manufactured goods to the Soviet Union, it would increase unemployment in Germany. That was the situation.
Trade relations take precedence. The famine is regarded as a strictly internal Soviet affair. The Western governments make their peace with genocide. The communist writer Mykola Khvilyovey reacts to the destruction of his people by starvation, the mass arrests of his friends and party members by taking his life. The party strongman Nikola Skripnik is denounced as an enemy of the state. He, too, commits suicide.
These suicides came to symbolically represent the end of an epoch in the history of Ukraine. Up to that time, we believed that a normal national development was possible. As they taught us, a culture socialist in content and national in form.
Stalin ends the famine with a single decree. Having broken the Ukrainian farmers, he can afford to give out grain on the collectives during the harvest in 1933. 1934. Purges take place in the cities and mark the end of Ukrainian participation in the running of their country. 27,000 Ukrainian communists are arrested and replaced by Russians. Only 36 out of 259 Ukrainian writers survive as the terror intensifies. The jail cells are rapidly emptied as Ukrainian nationalism becomes an offense punishable by death. The purges stop when the Nazis invade Ukraine in June 1941. Millions perish as Hitler attempts to replace Stalin's shackles with his own. To divert attention away from their own brutalities, the Nazis invite an international commission to inspect the mass graves left from Soviet rule. In the town of Vinnytsia alone, the commission uncovers the bodies of over 9,000 brutally murdered farmers, workers, poets, priests. No one can estimate the full total of those who disappeared in Stalin's reign of terror. She never adapted to wearing chains. The Soviet Union denies to this day the famine ever took place, but the harvest of despair cannot ever be forgotten.
That's about as harrowing an hour this side of an hour with Dachau that I can imagine. And I think there's several points we ought to touch on, but perhaps to begin by the aesthetic point, since we are probing, among other things, why there was such a odd inhospitality to showing this documentary. It may very well be that it's part of human nature to simply not expose people to anything that gruesome unless a compelling reason to do so is understood as a motivating factor. Every year we see extended treatments of the Holocaust in Germany, and the animating reason for that is to guard always against the dangers of anti-Semitism or racism. But perhaps there has never been advanced a reason for exhuming this particular episode. Unless it also should inform us. And the question I would like to begin with is to ask Mr. Conquest to cast that particular point. Let me just say that we were turning to this program having seen this documentary, and that our guests are Dr. Robert Conquest, the author of the forthcoming and definitive book on this, in which he calls The Harvest of Sorrow, Soviet Collectivization and the Terror Famine, and also is the author of The Great Terror. We have, in addition, Mr. Harrison Salisbury, retired correspondent from the New York Times, and a Sovietologist of great renown, Christopher Hitchens, an editor of Nation magazine, correspondent for London Spectator. What about that point, Mr. Conquest?
Well, I think you're right. The this was a true picture we saw. And yes, it does instruct us, and it instructs us about the world today. We have forgotten it, except through certain reports. It hasn't really hit the Western consciousness, because it's a rather complicated subject. I mean, there are famines everywhere. But if you look at this, it's the only famine where you don't see relief workers. No food, soup kitchens, nothing. Even in Ethiopia, you see relief work. And this was the one, it was the other way around. They take the last grain from the peasant. And I think why it's important is you have this major thing in which more people were killed in every country in the First World War. And we don't have a general history of it. And it hasn't...
Say that again. More people were killed
in the Ukraine
than in
all countries in the First World War, the belligerents put together. And it hasn't hit us. And it is part of the past of the Soviet Union, of the Soviet leadership, in fact. I mean, Gromyko, the president of the country, joined the party at this time, when the party's main objective was the crushing of the peasantry and the Ukraine. And come to that, the new head of the agitation and propaganda department of the Central Committee, Yakovlev, he came to that job from being ambassador in Canada, where 3 years ago he issued on the 50th anniversary of the famine, 32-33, he issued a communique on the so-called famine in the Ukraine, denying its existence. And so it's part of their consciousness. It's not only part of the history that produced the ruling group in the Soviet Union, it's part of the thing that they have not yet abreacted. They have not mentioned the truth about it. A few novels have given odd bits
It is as though Hitler had survived and there was a continuation of the Third Reich and they denied ever having molested the Jews. It's the equivalent of that.
More or less the same thing. And in fact, Kolakowski does give the great Polish philosopher, does have a piece about the Nazis. The Nazism is not the same as Hitlerism. You know, the Nazis were ruling now. Well, they can't be expected to tell all about their past. Yes, you have a parallel there.
Okay, let's get to the factual question. Did either of you detect any inaccuracies or distortions or embellishments or appoggiaturas that you find hypertheatrical or incorrect or misleading?
Well, it's very hard to answer that, Bill, because it is such a terrible thing. And so many people did die of starvation. And not only of starvation, but they were shot, they were tortured. Every possible thing you can do to human beings occurred in this period of time. So how can you present it without it being sitting comfortably in your living room watching these scenes, without it seeming perhaps to some to be over melodramatic? It doesn't really disturb me that I'm certain from my familiarity with a lot of documentaries that it's a mishmash of all kinds of things put together. It may not be specifically accurate on each one of these horrible corpses actually was in the Ukraine or was in some other place, but in general there were people exactly like that. I have, I think, perhaps one question about it, and this has nothing to do with this being in the Ukraine. I believe that by concentrating on the Ukraine, where so much of this horror happened, that we lose sight of the fact that the same horrors were happening in many other large areas of Russia, in the Don country, in the North Caucasus, in the Volga.
Well, the North Caucasus is thought of as part of the Ukraine for these purposes.
No, it's not part of the Ukraine.
Well, in that picture it was.
Well, it is. North Caucasus is not in the Ukraine.
New York is not New England, but the fact of the matter is that they showed a map in which they pointed North Caucasus as part of the area that this episode covered.
Ah, yes, that's true. That is exactly right. It did occur in the North Caucasus and the whole Volga region, and it occurred in the Don country, where scenes exactly like this could have been taken. It occurred in the area north of the Ukraine. It occurred in Belarusia, because this was a policy applied right straight across the board by Stalin. And I wouldn't want people to think that he confined it just to the Ukraine.
But isn't that like saying, well, Hitler killed a lot of gypsies too, so why do we talk about the Jews so much?
It's a little broader than that. He just went straight across the board with this damn thing, and
and it didn't make much difference where you lived. You
I think surely people who've had not just this visited upon them, but who've had it denied that it was visited upon them, who have been, as it were, insulted in that way, have the right to insist on the specificity of their suffering. I don't think it's sectarian for Ukrainians to say, look, us too, we too have a terrible drama and Holocaust in our past.
But
you asked me earlier, Mr. Buckley, why I hadn't contradicted you, and I hadn't time to say it was because you'd taken such care to avoid controversy up till then. Yeah. But for the sake not just of controversy, let me make a point. I think it's a good film, and I think it ought to be shown. I don't know what the objections to it were, and I'm glad whatever they were, they've been overcome. My only criticism would be, to take up the question you asked me, at the very end, where they have the absurd picture of, as it were, Nazis being able to invite foreign guests to demonstrate the inhumanity of others. I mean, an irony, really obscene, grotesque. And you notice in that picture...
But you heard the text, it said adding millions of corpses of their own.
Oh, indeed. So yes, there's no question about that.
There was no sense of affinity.
But it says, and it does say, that it was the Nazis who did it. Now, the unpleasant fact is that a very large number of the Waffen-SS regiments fighting in that part of the world were Ukrainian. That the massacre of Jews, of the Jewish population of Babi Yar, was, as far as we know, carried out almost entirely by Ukrainian volunteers and levies and so forth, and that there was a fatal compromise by the leaders of, some of the leaders of Ukrainian nationalism, with the Third Reich. Now, I make this point only so that it's on the table, as it were. This is still remembered, and it's a matter of very lively controversy now. There was a very interesting battle at Radio Liberty recently about how to commemorate the Ukrainian National Day, because it turns out that there was a bogus proclamation of Ukrainian independence in 1941, which ended with the words, glory to Adolf Hitler. And the Ukrainians argue about this, Jewish people working...
Who was initially viewed as a liberator.
Trotsky's friend of Stalin during
the 2 years.
Well, it was for that reason that I mentioned earlier that Trotsky's foreboding was that Hitler could even win. Such was the hatred felt for Stalinism.
But you wanted to make a factual correction or a comment?
Yes, I think this is it's not untrue. Of course, there were Ukrainian war criminals, as there were others in Western countries. Come to that, the Israelis. I've been going to this because I'm writing about the anti-Semitic period in the Soviet Union. So in the great anti-Semitic period of 45 to 53, so I've looked into this rather carefully, and there were, the Israelis list 11,000 Ukrainian war criminals, which is far too many, but in a population of 36 to 40 million, it was about then, it isn't all that much. It's not the case that the Ukrainian nationalist organizations collaborated with the Germans. They did try to in the first few days. As indeed it comes to that, Khrushchev tells us that most of the Jewish population of the Western Ukraine tried to go over to the, or indeed were allowed at that time to go over to the German side. There were Ukrainians fighting in the Red Army. There were Ukrainian criminals among these secret policemen, Balitsky, for example.
But we're criminals under the aspect of the heavens, aren't we?
Well, if they'd come to England, they'd have found
some... As collaborators of Stalin.
Well, you can call it that way, but I mean by war criminal actual crime. I mean, Simon Wiesenthal rightly says, political collaboration with the Germans is one thing, and criminals quite different. Like, say, the Bulgarian government, which was fought for the Germans, or the Finnish, but didn't allow their Jews to be taken away, anything like that. There were different things going on. But the Ukrainian nationalist guerrillas fought both the Germans and the communists continually, right from 42, 43, 41 on. And there were up to, I think, nearly 100, there were several score Obliditches and Oroduras among the Ukrainian villages. Mm. It was, although of course there were Ukrainian war criminals, this cannot, I think Wiesenthal again says, that you cannot blame the Ukrainians for a few hundred or a few thousand war criminals.
Well, let's ask a historic question. I found this documentary a little bit confusing on two points. It seemed simultaneously to be saying that disinformation had prevailed, and that the civilized world didn't know what was happening. On the other hand, it then showed editorials in Belgian and German and American papers offering aid. Now, those two positions are irreconcilable at a view to some level. Let me ask Harrison Salisbury, who, after all,
you were a child during this period, but you remember. At what point was it clear to you, as a student of international affairs, that the New York Times principal correspondent had lied about this terrible episode? And at what point did you feel that the truth had been penetrated by the intelligentsia of the Western world?
In the first place, Bill, I was not a child at that time. I was a young newspaper man during that period of time. I was not paying much attention.
Well, you were about 22 or 3. Well.
I was not paying much attention to affairs in the Soviet Union, I must admit. The first mention I had of Durante was when he wrote that famous book, I Write As I Please, and I loved that title because I like to do that myself. And I knew nothing about Russia, and I just accepted this idea. I didn't get on to exactly what Durante was doing and what he made up until I wrote my book about the New York Times, Without Fear or Favor.
In 51.
Which was about 5-6 years ago. And
the second book.
That was the book about
Without Fear or Favor,
the whole New York Times. And I then made one of my principal efforts to establish what the devil it was that Durante was all about and what he did. And I delved into the Times records, and I think I've done the only real investigation of what Durante was. Totally cynical man, absolutely, without any, wanted to get ahead, and really a very bad correspondent from the word go. And why the Times put up with him during all these years, I simply don't know. When he got a job in Paris, during World War I, the Paris correspondent of the Times said that if this man is going to work under me, I'm going to quit. I can't stand him. He didn't. He was sent to Russia. He was sent to Russia, I think, because Mr. Ox felt we ought to have a correspondent. We didn't have anybody in Russia. From the very word go, he first went to Riga. He missed out on the first big famine, the famine of 1921. He didn't even report that for Riga, and Floyd Gibbons of the Chicago Tribune scooped him. He went into Russia, he made up his mind Stalin was going to win, and he played it that way right straight through. There were plenty of people on the Times who knew that he was not reporting, doing a good job particularly on this famine. I have a whole stack of memos that were written about this man internally in the Times. And almost immediately after he got his Pulitzer, which was just after that, almost simultaneously with this awful performance on the famine, he left the Times, but nobody seems to understand that. After 1933-34, he did special stories, but the Times had nothing to do with him from that time on.
Why was he privily telling the British Embassy that maybe 10 million people...
He was an Englishman.
Was it just to
Durante.
Keep his plate warm with the diplomatic
community? No. Durante was exactly that kind of a man. He was a perfectly cynical man. He was on excellent terms with Muggeridge, for God's sake, who said he was such a big liar. Well, he's right.
And he was an Englishman.
That's right. And his principal friend...
Oh, I don't mean why was it the British he told? I mean,
but
why was he telling anybody?
This is the way he told him. Because he was not... He reported in the Times what he thought he wanted to report in the Times to keep his position to...
Well, now, present his viewpoint. Why was the Durante deception so successful? That is to say, if there were as many sharpshooters around as Muggeridge and others, why is it that the Soviet view of the non-famine prevailed?
It didn't. Let's be honest about that. It didn't. There was a lot of reporting, and Bob is much better equipped to do that. There was a good deal of excellent reporting. There were many obstacles to getting out in the field. Muggeridge didn't get out in the field. Durante had this free trip in which he saw nothing, but several correspondents, including a number who were not very famous, did get out in the field and did report it in the papers. The Herald Tribune reported it. The English papers reported it. The German papers reported it. And so from that standpoint, this documentary gives you an impression that it was really suppressed when it was.
Tom Jones got in, didn't
Tom
he?
Tom Jones got
That's
in.
Right.
There were a lot of people. I think the thing isn't quite that, is that by getting not only Durante, but a lot of similar reporting, they confuse the issue.
That's
and by denying it officially, someone is right, how you or me, the ordinary reader, are going to decide. This is anti-Soviet propaganda, says one lot. The truth is what Durante says. It did confuse the issue, and people weren't able to get a clear picture. And I think that succeeded.
I wasn't around at the time, so I'll just say I wasn't even a young newspaper man. But I think that probably by 1933, one still hadn't entered the period of the 20th century when people were more inclined to believe the worst. I mean, would naturally believe that an atrocity was most likely to be true. I have a feeling that it was still relatively innocent. I mean, people were
sure, the defense of Stalin by many members of the West intelligentsia was of course rampant.
Absolutely, and
that continued really for another 20 years. As a matter of fact, it was only the denunciation of Stalin by Khrushchev that
we got a lot of them around.
That's right. 95% of the American communists, I was told by Howard Fast, within that month, renounced the party. So the climatic event, as far as it was concerned, didn't come until 1956.
That's when they admitted it, and they never admitted this.
That's
one.
Right.
So it's
still... It wasn't anything we could prove. They had to admit it. Yeah.
But this all occurred before the purges. That's another thing to remember.
But in one of your books, you referred to Maxim Litvinov as, of course, one of your heroes.
Yes.
Now, you can't simultaneously have said that and believed that he was in any sense an executioner of this act of genocide. So therefore, you were ignorant at least up until that point, weren't you?
I don't believe that Litvinov was an executioner, frankly. I think that he's brought in here because of his role in the League of Nations. You see, Litvinov is the man who was almost executed himself. He slept with a pistol under his pillow.
Well, everybody was almost executed after a while.
Yeah, he came a little bit closer to it than almost anybody I know, and. He was outside of this. This is not in his realm. I'm sure he knew a lot about it. I don't know any Russian who didn't know a lot about it. But, you know, people do know a lot about these regimes. We know people in Germany that knew a lot about those.
But was it about him that was heroic?
He stood out against Stalin on a whole lot of issues, Bill. And, boy, anybody who stood out against Stalin in those conditions gets a vote from me.
But Lev Kopolev, who we saw in the show, and who's a marvelous, interesting guy.
Absolutely.
Who's a character in one of Solzhenitsyn's novels.
Good friend of his.
Says that he, and says in his book, which I've read, a wonderful book, that he knew what he was doing, and so it wasn't a question of denying it to oneself.
Right.
They thought it was worthwhile. I mean, that was the thing. He thought, this will pass and a better day will come, which I think distinguishes him from someone who would have been doing the same thing for Hitler, for example. I mean, I think those people did evil that evil might come. I think the Kopolevs could persuade themselves that a better world could still be made.
You had a German diplomat on here, a marvelous one, who talks about how he knew all these different things and so forth and so on. He was in Moscow in 1939 in the German embassy. He gave Chip Bohlen, a young man in our embassy, the inside advance information on the Nazi-Stalin pact. He was working for Hitler, if you want to say that. But he also was doing what he could against Hitler. And I admire him.
Well, I think that Mr. Hitchens made an extremely interesting point when he said that the presumption back in 1933 was against anything that egregious having happened, and therefore you inclined to a position that argued against its happening. Now, when did that change? Did it change only after we marched into the concentration camps in Germany, would you say? That the scale of this kind of thing became something we could recognize?
I think it came before that, Bill. I think it came very early on. I think it came, the first people who really got onto this were correspondents who'd gone into Moscow, all for communism, all for Lenin, all for Stalin, and these were people like Bill Chamberlain, and I don't know what Muggeridge thought when he went in there, but Louis Fisher, a number of these
Muggeridge
people.
Muggeridge certainly started as a sympathizer.
Eugene Lyons, for heaven's sakes, who went to...
Oh, Muggeridge was a total communist.
All of them, and they began to see what the reality was, and boy, did they change. I think that's what it was.
But this change didn't have a lot of connective tissue with massive thinking in the diplomatic world, did it?
I don't know.
Well, put it this way. If it had been widely known that something on this scale had happened, would Roosevelt have chosen that same season in which to repeal the non-recognition of the Soviet Union? Here we are discussing aborting a summit conference because one Western journalist is detained illegally in Moscow. Surely if we had had any general sense of what Stalin had just finished doing, we would have at least postponed a diplomatic démarche with him, wouldn't we?
There are two factors in that, as I see it, and maybe I'm all wet about it. One was the rise of Hitler, which was scaring people, and the Triple Alliance of Hitler and Italy and Japan, and we were worried about that, very much worried about it. The other was the depression, looking for trade and jobs and things of that kind. I think those factors probably were pragmatic factors. I don't think they had anything to do with whether Stalin was a good guy, a bad guy, or murdering people for breakfast.
Litvinov also promised to repeal the Comintern, didn't he? That was part of
that was during World War II, Bill. He repealed the Comintern then.
He in fact did then, but he promised in 1933, he promised Roosevelt, that international communist activities would be curtailed.
What he did was...
And then they changed it to Comintern, Common Form, and so on.
That came during World War II.
Well, is there an explanation for the fact that the average person who will have seen this account will have been ignorant of it up until now?
Oh, I think that's true. Well, sure.
Now, see, is there an explanation for it?
Is there an explanation for it?
You mean you have none?
I'm not going to offer one. I've said all I can think about it.
Well, in Bob's book, The Great Terror, there's a mention of the Ukrainian famine. I don't know. I mean, there it is. Now you've written a whole book about it. I mean, I feel I've known there was a famine in the Ukraine for a very long time. I couldn't have told you very much about it. I would have said that it was, I would probably also have overstated the extent to which it was a function of the general disaster of Stalin's collectivization policy.
Okay.
I think the whole business of the Stalin period is so immense, and I think people feel they know about the catastrophe of Stalinism.
Well,
they may not feel they need to know they need to know the specific and...
See, I think Stalin's lives of maybe 50, 60, 70 million Russian people. Mm-hmm. This is an important chunk, but my God, who knows all the lives
he
could take?
Okay, well, now, 2 years ago, Prime Minister Mulroney of Canada made some ritual commemoration of the 50th anniversary and got denounced most violently by the Soviet ambassador, who said that any reference to a famine in the Ukraine was, quote, 100% lie. Now, given the fact that Soviet history is such as it is, and it's awfully malleable, as we all know, is on record as acknowledging the atrocities of Stalin, why is the Soviet Union not willing to throw into the anti-Stalinist inventory this particular episode? You must be giving that a lot of thought.
They haven't really. They've withdrawn, in effect, a lot of the attacks on Stalin that took place in Khrushchev's time. And when you look up somebody who was illegally shot, posthumously rehabilitated, you got half the entries in the encyclopedia. That's all gone. They just die. And they backtracked on that a hell of a lot. They've showed hints in Khrushchev's time of not dealing with the famine, never that, but dealing with the dekulakization and collectivization. Mistakes were made, too much terror was used. That has been backtracked on. They will not touch the famine.
Why? But,
well, the two reasons, of course, in the first place, it's easier to defend. I think, as we're all implying, Stalin's methods were very... He could confuse issues.
The scrambled eggs business.
If you have a famine, as Hitch said, the famine is a famine. You don't know more about it. You know the result of some policy, but not the same as blocking the Ukraine's borders and not letting bread in and starving the villagers on purpose. It's the same with his anti-Semitic period, the doctor's plot. It was absolute anti-Semitic thing, but he put in two or three Gentile doctors. So if you say, well, this isn't anti-Semitic at all. Some of them aren't Jewish. Stalin was a very... He didn't put anything in a clear way. Even his opponents didn't know quite what he was doing when they were trying to outmaneuver him. It's one that it has been possible to keep it under hatches for a bit. Because once you admit it, and how can you admit these things? It's a moral albatross around their neck. I mean, they ought to say...
Well, we admit the fact that we were a slave-owning country once. We admit the fact that we deprived the black people of their civil rights for 100 years. We can absorb that. Is that only because we are a pluralist and democratic society that this becomes possible?
Well, we're not we in the same sense. The we there is the Communist Party of the Soviet Union.
Yeah.
We don't belong to any particular thing called the Slave Owners Party of the United States.
That's right.
And it's not that there are many people, there are many writers in the Soviet Union. Some of the novelists have hinted at the famine. In fact, one novelist said the year 1933 a terrible tragedy took place in which there's not a word in the textbooks. That got out in a novel. A sentence or two can be found in Soviet novels like that.
In this new edition of Vasily Grossman, which has just come out. With a marvelous report of it. It hasn't been published in the Soviet Union yet, but it probably will be.
Yeah, but it'll be a test, won't it, of whether Mr. Gorbachev is only rhetorical about reform. The one to look for, in my opinion, is the rehabilitation of Bukharin, which not even Khrushchev would go as far as allowing, or even considering. Bukharin's family still alive, petitioning for him to be rehabilitated. And I think the reason that they gag on Bukharin is precisely because of his battle with Stalin on agricultural policy. Yeah. They'd have to admit all that, and I think actually the rehabilitation of Bukharin is a touchstone.
Well, could it be that this occasional historical hygiene in which they engage from time to time, the 1956 episode being primary among them, is really a reflection, not of any evolution, not of any moral reform, but of internal quarrels which, for whatever reason, dissipate by that particular exercise. In April of 1956, the crimes of Stalin are denounced by Khrushchev. In October of 1956, Khrushchev sends tanks to run down student freedom fighters in Hungary, suggesting really that he hadn't taught himself the lessons that he sought rather theatrically to dramatize as distinctive to Stalin. I guess this is a commentary that asks, aren't we yet again being coaxed to believe that in Gorbachev we see the beginnings of a new Soviet creature, without any historical comfort for that thesis?
I don't think that morality has much to do with the politicians in general, Bill. Oh, I'm sorry to be so cynical.
No, I think it has nothing to do with the distinction between Hubert Humphrey and Hitler. Even if they're both opportunists.
Yeah, but I've yet to see morality activating the Politburo in any of these cases. It is pragmatic politics of one sort or another.
On the other, it must be extremely difficult to be a Marxist and to say that we don't want to study history. There is a more than usual contradiction there. To give you an example, a counterexample of our own, because I thought we were a little smug about the pluralism factor and the impossibility of these considerations. Last year, Secretary Weinberger went before Congress and urged them not to pass a resolution commemorating the Turkish genocide of the Armenians. And the reason he gave for saying that his department would continue to refer to that as only alleged was not historical. He didn't say we have new evidence that it might not have been all that bad, or he said it would offend our Turkish ally.
Well, that's
now if that can happen, if that can happen, the relative size of the United States and Turkey, the relative freedom, the absolute clarity of the record on the matter, and you can get a man who can say in a democratic forum, don't refer to it because it might upset someone to whom we're selling weapons, then I think we have little enough right to be smug. B, we can observe the pathology by which people agree not to mention things.
Well, you wouldn't expect the Secretary of State of the United States to arrive at the airport in Moscow and say, where is Isaac Babel?
It would be a very good question.
I think so too.
I don't see why not. What can they do about it?
But it's one thing to understand diplomatic stratagems and niceties. It's something else to see how sometimes they seek into the popular culture. The interview with Gorbachev done by Time magazine finishes with, the voice is extraordinary, deep but also quite soft, low and melodious. He says, quoting Gorbachev, hundreds of millions of people are going hungry. We, all of us, just have no right to ignore such a situation.
Well,
the Time magazine has a low threshold for arrant cynicism, but it was not trespassed on this particular occasion. Talking to a guy who still instructs his ambassador in Canada to denounce Mulroney for merely mentioning that there was a famine, hunger, diet in the Ukraine. Isn't this something to guard against? Aren't you alarmed by this aspect of the problem?
Well, Harrison, you met Stalin, didn't you?
No, I never met Stalin.
Met, but he was,
he was not
was
meeting
charming.
Newspaper men in my day.
He was charming. A lot of people thought he was charming.
Well, I should tell you this. Whitaker Chambers told you one time that Walter Duranty got the first interview with Stalin ever secured by a Western journalist. He prepared for it avidly. And so he was determined to put Stalin at his ease. And so he arrived and he was ushered in. He said, "Well, Comrade Stalin, the whole West normally thinks of you with a pipe in your hand. Where is your pipe?" Stalin said, "I left it downstairs." Which is a nice icebreaker for that.
It's a lovely story, but Durante did not get the first interview with Stalin.
Oh, did he not?
He did not, and he was sore as hell because he didn't.
Well,
he probably made the remark about the pipe, though.
The second or whatever. you ask him whether he knew Stalin intending to probe what question?
Well, I just thought Stalin, like Gorbachev, was widely reported as having great charm.
Oh, yeah.
So,
somebody charmed the hell out of Armand Hammer, didn't they? I think that was Lenin, wasn't it?
Everybody can let
Hammer
stayed charmed, didn't he?
I don't quite want to lose my Weinberger Armenia point, because the argument that many people made at the time about Stalin was, well, you know, maybe there are some terrible things going on, but now is not the right time to criticize the Soviet Union, because now the task is the defeat of the Anti-Comintern Pact of Nazi Germany and Italy and Japan. And so, purely instrumental, un-Marxist reasoning, but very political, saying, you know,
yeah, but is there ever a point at which one shouldn't remind oneself of original sin? And in the case of the Soviet Union, original sin is highly articulated.
Yeah.
That is to say, its opportunism continues, its appetite fog, its indisposition to the horrors of sadism goes on in Afghanistan this very morning. So is it important for the intelligentsia to say episodes like this aren't merely historical antiquities? They are the kind of appetite exercised by this kind of people.
Well, to borrow from your very vivid comparison, Hitler and Hubert Humphrey, one would have to say you can't say that Gorbachev and Stalin have no difference.
No.
You may choose to say, and I know you're very keen on insisting that the Soviet system remains the Soviet system and so forth, but how useful is this insistence if it doesn't allow us to make the distinction between Gorbachev
and
Stalin? Indeed, at the time, the choices offered by the Communist Party were quite wide. I mean, hence Stalin's need to destroy Bukharin, to destroy Trotsky, to destroy Rykov.
It isn't what is different that is interesting, it's what they have in common that's interesting, isn't it? We know that Gorbachev went to law school at a moment when going to law school had only the function of becoming a prosecutor.
And Stalin went to Theological Academy.
That's right.
And when he became General Secretary, his mother said he was a foolish boy. If he'd stayed in the seminary, he could have been a bishop by now.
That's right. Perhaps it would have been better had he.
Well, there's a kind of profanation implied there. I don't know. But,
you insist then on the similarities.
Well, I guess another way to put it is, if Gorbachev were to face a crisis, which he interpreted as Stalin, as Stalin interpreted his crises, is there anything he would hesitate to do?
Well, there's one quite interesting footnote, and that is, you talk about rehabilitation, Molotov, the old villain who was the second of those three walking across the Stalin, Molotov, and Kaganovich, has been very much rehabilitated after being accused of crime of every sort. He'd ridden into the party, and the other day he gave a long interview saying how much I love this new regime, might have my backing in every way.
His counterpart was hanged at Nuremberg, but Molotov has been rehabilitated. Mm. Meanwhile, Hess stays in jail. Those are kind of antiquarian anomalies, aren't they?
Yeah,
I think they are. And Molotov is, 95? And he certainly has done everything known to man that is bad.
Yeah.
I don't think it makes much difference at this particular point. He's
an existence replete with horror.
Bill, one of your points about why do they keep it up. We get back, I think, also, which we haven't done, to the Ukrainian point.
Yes.
There's quite a lot more Ukrainian nationalism showing in the last few years. And if you start admitting that this genocidal type action was taken, and Harrison, I think you're not quite right when you say that it spread everywhere. It did not go to Belarus. There was a blockade along the Ukrainian border, and it wasn't allowed. There was food the other side. There are people who lived in villages one side or the other, managed to swim across and get food. And although it's quite true the North Caucasus is not part of the Ukraine, but at that time it was largely inhabited by Ukrainians. They were almost all either sent north to the Arctic because of the Kuban Cossacks and so forth, or starved. And the Don area was not Ukrainian, but it was Cossack. And it was, although Russian in a sense, it's very much a dialect in between. And the lower Volga, certainly, but this was mainly minor Germans, Cossacks, and so on.
I think there were an awful lot of Cossacks in the North Caucasus, particularly after the Civil War.
What I mean is the emphasis, although there were other areas, they were mainly Ukrainian, and it was did not strike Russia properly, except a few border areas, and not Belarus. Of those who died, certainly 6 out of 7 would have been Ukrainian or Ukrainian Cossacks.
Bob, looking at your book, which is such a marvelous documentation of this, that your figures on the starvation in the Volga Basin and the Kuban, the North Caucasus, indicated actually a higher percentage of population deaths in that area than in the Ukraine.
In the Kuban, that is, I think so, because it wasn't only famine. Yeah. They lived, the Kuban Cossacks lived in these huge townlets.
Yes.
And they rose in rebellion, a lot of them, and they were actually slaughtered and sent north. They weren't just starved. So the North Kuban part probably suffered in proportion more than the Ukraine.
Above 25-30%?
Of the rural population, it was about 25% in the Ukraine, yes.
Can I propose a topic, I mean, which might make us divide in interesting ways? Basic founding principle of the Cold War, as I understand it, is that the Soviet Union is like Nazism, and therefore you can't appease it,
or vice versa,
and so forth. Now I don't think that's true, even with this evidence for my eyes. I think there's a difference in kind between the Ukrainian famine and between the Nazi Holocaust, and I think that the evolution of the Soviet system is not like the evolution of Nazism.
Well, we don't know what the other Nazism would have been.
Well, no, but we saw the direction it was taking.
Well,
before it was stopped.
A fascinating point, because I've always thought that it was so much the creature of this one madman that it'll be extremely hard for historians in the future to taxonomize Nazism. What in the hell did it mean? Well, it made an obsessive hatred of the Jews and a certain Irenaeus passion and imperialism. But beyond that, it had really no philosophy.
Anti-communism is really strong cement. I mean,
no philosophical basis, whereas Marxism does.
Does, yes. But how say you? I mean, when you read and study the Soviet Union, read about and study and write about it, I mean, do you think of it in
I never thought of it as being the same as Nazi Germany in the ways I regard it as a phenomenon of its own.
Equally unscrupulous, you meant by the same.
I mean, I think that most of the exhortations to which one's subjected in Cold War terms are to the effect that, you know, we're really up against this implacable totalitarian, unsleeping enemy, and that here is evidence of its ruthlessness.
But you can be an unsleeping enemy without being an exact equivalent to the Nazis. I think your other point is more interesting. I would regard them as implacable, but that they can take a long run. The Nazis, for various reasons, even regardless of the oddity of their thought, were hemmed in Germany and had to win straight away or not. Mm. The whole tendency of not only Soviet, but even earlier Russian imperialism has been take it easy and spread slowly and make your points. But I think that to say that they're implacable, that they say so themselves, and all other regimes are in principle illegitimate. But your point about the Holocaust, I think that is also, you're right, that the Jewish Holocaust was a thing of its own, so quite different, much worse in many respects. It was an attempt to totally destroy. I mean, you may well say that to crush the Ukraine, to enslave the Ukraine, to kill a quarter of the population is very bad and nasty. It is not quite the same as killing the lot. And I think this is recognized.
Or as wanting to kill the lot.
Or wanting to kill the lot. It is not quite the same. Nevertheless, I don't think one can just say the Holocaust is so bad, therefore we can't cover the Ukraine as well. I think
I just wonder whether there isn't an implicit message in some of these films, some of these rival nationalisms that are edging us in this direction, to say if anything's better than communism.
Well, that is obviously false.
Yeah.
Well, it's talking about shame. The Ukrainians don't want to lose their national identity.
Yeah.
There's a lot of Ukrainian passion behind this documentary.
which among other things is saying, look, we exist, we are a nation. Any journalist who's used the word Russia to cover that entire geographical area knows the punishment that we get.
Yeah.
Saying, what's Russian about the Ukrainian?
But you know the best thing, Harrison was referring to Vasily Grossman's books.
Yeah.
Who is Vasily Grossman?
The Grossman.
Who I quote quite a lot in this, in my book, yeah. on the famine and so on, because he is one of the best and most moving witnesses about the Ukrainian famine. And he is himself not only Jewish, and Jewish from the Ukraine, but his mother was killed in Treblinka. He wrote the great documentary, The Hell of Treblinka, in fact was the co-editor of the Soviet section of the Black Book on the Nazi Terror, which was never published in the Soviet Union, incidentally, but it is available here. And he takes in his, all his books, a complete charity and feel for whoever is being killed, how many of them, the Ukrainians, the Jews, he treats them not as identical. He says the Jewish thing was much worse, but there's no patronizingness about him at all, any direction.
I have another view about this business of killing, of making the Nazis exceptionalists because they killed Jews, basically. They also killed many other people, and the Holocaust was one of the great tragedies, one of the great horrors of our time. But to me, the Stalin killing of his own people by the millions and doing it repeatedly from the very earliest times again and again and again, something like that seems to me to be even more horrible in a sense, turning on your own people. Hitler turned on his people. After all, most of the original Jews that he killed were Germans, and they regarded themselves as German Jews, and he turned on them. Then he embraced people from all kinds of other places and began to kill them. But the Stalin crime of turning on your own country and turning, in a sense, first on the people closest to you, he wiped out everybody who was close to him, and then his circles grew broader and broader and broader until in this final madness of the doctor's plot and the period in which he was about to die, he was going to kill off the Ukrainians, he was going to ship all the rest of the Jews in Russia out to Siberia. God knows who he wasn't going to kill. And I think this towers above anything else.
It's sort of a personal incarnation of evil that almost detached it from doctrine.
That's right.
Yes. As probably was true of Hitler. I mean, what's left of Nazi quotes doctrine is not very much, is it?
Well, for example, I mean, there were, even in Eugenia Ginsburg's book, I think there are people in the Gulag who are sitting around saying, if only Stalin knew this was going on, he'd put a stop to it. Now, you obviously can't imagine anyone sitting in a Nazi concentration camp thinking, if Hitler knew about this, you know, we'd soon be out of here.
I never heard
any more than you can.
That.
Whereas there were communists and socialists of the time who said of Stalin that he'd betrayed the revolution and betrayed socialism. You couldn't very well say of Hitler he'd betrayed Nazism, could you? That he was a bad Nazi or he'd given it a bad name. It was what it was. Now this is the distinction I'm trying to suggest.
You remember that famous Lowe cartoon in which Hitler and Stalin meet, and the cut line is the Prince of Evil, I believe, and then the rejoinder. What did he call? What did the other one call him?
Vicious.
Anyway, they were two of the same kind. Yeah. It was a perfectly beautiful cartoon.
Yeah. Acknowledging each other's preeminence.
Yes,
of evil.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
Well, we have only a minute and a half left. I think it probably safe to say that we all agree that this starting documentary should have been produced and shown, but none of us contends that the experience was in any sense pleasurable. I suppose only in the sense that confirming historical truths gives the historian pleasure, but it's not widely pleasurable, is it? Do you conclude, therefore, that it's hard to criticize a network for declining to exhibit it?
I think it's a very close call. I rather think that it should be exhibited myself.
Good God, yes. I mean, when you think of what PAP is pushed out all the rest of the time, even under the rubric of current affairs
But PAP is PAP because there's an appetite for PAP, right? It would be called caviar otherwise.
Sure, but no one can say that this is this appetite goes unslaked. Here is simply an hour for reflection and consideration of the Ukrainian famine. I think it's extraordinary to deny it.
Thank you, Christopher Hitchens of The Nation magazine, and thank you, Harrison Salisbury, and thank you, Robert Cox. Conquest, author of Harvest of Sorrow, and my thanks to the producers of Harvest of Despair and to PBS for sponsoring its showing. Ladies and gentlemen.